All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to AP 8.3. This is when the fun begins, ladies and gentlemen, and I say that with a slash S. This is when this unit starts to become miserable if it wasn't already for you, but we gotta get it. We gotta get after it. So in this podcast, I'm gonna really harp on the weak acids and bases here today. If you're looking for the strong, you're looking for vodcast 8.2. We're gonna talk about how to identify those, how to actually calculate pH or pOH, and then we're also going to sneak in there this idea of percent ionization, which sounds like, oh my God, more math. But actually, we're going to do the same skills or 80% of the same skills in order to find pH or percent ionization. Let's do it to it. So a quick review in case you haven't seen this enough, right? Again, what makes an acid weak? Same thing that makes an electrolyte weak. If you are weak, that means you have equilibrium. That means you are slightly soluble. That means that you partially dissociate. Okay, that means you do not go to completion, and that means that we have this state of equilibrium. Remember those seven pictures from last PowerPoint, last vodcast? Yeah, buddy! Here they are, back at it again. Oh my God, I'm back at it again. All right, so yet again, just one last reminder of where we've been and where we're going. Weak acids, all that, and a bag of chips. All those weak acids and all those strong acids are acids. And they all affect water the same way. But what makes strong strong and what makes weak weak is that a strong acid, 100% of it dissociates. Every single HA that goes in there, we go to completion, and therefore all of the HA, remember, the concentration of the acid equals the concentration of the hydronium and the concentration of the conjugate base. The problem here is that it is not 100 dissociation for the weak acid. And so that brings up all of the fun we had with a particulate diagram. Whether we look at the manic HAs, whether we look at the, are you prim and proper? Proper H3O pluses. Or whether we look at the weird looking ice table horizontally, or the other textbook that does the ice table horizontally, Zumdahl, shout out Zumdahl. Whatever, clever, ladies and gentlemen, means the same. What it all means is that strong acids go to completion, they completely dissociate, we have zero HA left, and we have all H plus and all A minus, whereas for dissociation, for the weak acid, it's going to have a state of equilibrium. So what that means is a huge problem, ladies and gentlemen. What that really means is that unfortunately for us, the concentration of H plus does not equal the concentration of the HA. And so we've got a lot of splaining to do. Essentially, what we actually have to do, ladies and gentlemen, is we've got to do what we did all last unit. Sons of Scotland, we've got to deal with equilibrium. As I told you all of last unit, all of unit 7, anytime I see these arrows, anytime I discuss or I hear the word equilibrium, anytime I hear weak, I'm immediately thinking K statement. And as I told you back in the past, we are going to write that K statement, write that K statement, write that K statement. Now, as we also went over in Unit 7, remember the only two species or states of matter we care about are aqueous or gaseous. We do not care about the liquid. So that's why a lot of the times I'm not being lazy. I'm never lazy. I'm just efficient. That's why a lot of times when I write my acid dissociation constant statements or even my acid dissociation statements, I ignore the water because water is always in the liquid form. So it is not going to be written in our case statement. And that's why I also am not prim and proper and I'm not putting H3O plus, I'm just putting H plus. But if you were to write the case statement for this reaction, for this dissociation, for this change, it's always product over reactant and it's always aqueous only. So the case statement, which we used to call KCs, would have just been concentration of first product H3O plus times concentration of second product A minus, AKA the conjugate base. And we put that only over the acid itself. We do not put water in there because water is a liquid. Again, if we completely ignore water, we can clean that H3O plus into just H plus, and it's the same thing. Now, because we're writing K statements for acids, that KC, that K concentration, that equilibrium constant using concentrations is now not going to be KC. It's now going to be KA. Dun, dun, dun. So, oh my God, I got to remember another thing, Mahan? No. No, it's still product over reactant, and it's still brackets over brackets, baby. And if you are stressing, don't worry, ladies and gentlemen. Yet again, money in the bank, shorty, what you drank. This KA statement is actually literally written on in your reference sheet. And this is the same statement for all weak acids. Okay. Now, again, the major, major key alert about this being a weak acid is, did you give me double arrows? You're going to see that moving forward, every weak acid problem, I'm going to have like either the KA written into the equation or into the problem itself, or maybe I'll have a KA written next to the equation, just like what we are seeing with KCs, just like what we are seeing with KPs. So if you see a KA value, ladies and gentlemen, if you see a double arrow, if it's not one of those seven that we memorized for the weak acid or for the strong acids, we know that they are weak. Now, again, what does that mean if you are weak? What that means if you are weak, ladies and gentlemen, that means that there's reversibility. And what that also means, if you have a very low K value, what that means, as we said back in Unit 7, is that if your K value is low, that means that equilibrium prefers to be on the left. What that means is that a weak acid is like a weak person. A weak person does not want to be alone. A weak person does not want to break off a friendship, break off a relationship. I can't be single again. I can't be alone. Are you kidding me? Oh my God, I need you, please. Right, like when you're in there, I've been in that moment, right? Somebody dumps you, you're like, I can't, my walls are falling, my world is colliding. Oh my God, I can't live without you. I've been there, I pleaded, I begged on my knees. I left Ocean City, Maryland, and came home to New Jersey and begged and pleaded on my knees, please don't leave, babe. But she did. And at the time I was very weak, but then I found a way to be strong. But these weak acids, ladies and gentlemen, they don't want to be, they don't want to be H plus and A minus. They want to be ha. They want to stay together. They strategically left a hoodie at your house so that they have to come get it one more time. Weak acids, weak bases as well. If they are weak, that means the forward does not want to occur. What it means is that the reverse actually wants to occur. What that actually means, ladies and gentlemen, and this is why on the ice table at equilibrium, the majority of the concentration, the acid concentration is greater than the concentration of H+. It's greater than the concentration of A-. What that means is that weak acids, remember, the opposite, the conjugate, is always opposite. So the weak acid gives us a conjugate base, but not only does it give us a conjugate base, it gives us a very strong conjugate base because it actually wants to live in the reverse. It actually wants to live as HA, not H plus and A minus. So this A minus is a very, very strong conjugate base because it wants to accept that H plus and get back to HA. What this also means, ladies and gentlemen, is that those strong acids we told you about last vodcast, they actually give you very weak conjugate bases because the strong acid wants to go forward. It wants to break up. It wants to be all alone. It wants to be A minus. It doesn't want anything to do with that H plus. What this also means with these weak acids is that we got an all new problem, ladies and gentlemen. We got a major, major issue. Yesterday, last vodcast, because it's a strong acid. Remember, pH is pH, guys. pH is very easy. No, it's not. Yes, it is. pH is very easy. It's just the negative log of H. Or H3O plus if you want to be proper. The problem with pH is not the equation. The problem is what the flip is H. That's the whole problem. Now, for a strong acid, as we did yesterday, last vodcast, the strong acid concentration is the H. Give me my point. Just memorize your seven acids. Let's go. But this is a weak acid. And weak acids, those concentrations do not equal each other. So we got a major problem here, ladies and gentlemen. We got a major, major issue to which we don't have a tissue. Looking at this problem, calculate the pH of a 1 molar hydrofluoric acid solution. Nothing seems too different up until this point from all of the problems we did yesterday. Here's where it starts to get nuts. All of a sudden, they're giving me a Ka value in the equation in the problem. Wait, what? They give me the dissociation and it has double arrows? What? Or maybe they give me the dissociation with the K statement over here. And again, with that K statement being so low, that tells me that HF is a weak acid. We went over yesterday why, but HF is a weak acid, even though HBr, HCl, and HI are strong. And because it's a weak acid, because that K value is so small, 0.00072, 72 hundred thousandths of a mole, that tells us that HF is a weak acid, and that tells us that it lives far to the left. So what that means is a huge, huge issue for me in terms of pH, because pH is very easy. It's just negative log of H, but what the hell is H? Oh, man. It's a shame. Ice tables. It's a shame. Ice tables. Too cold. It's a shame that we didn't spend any time to ever find out what an amount of something is at equilibrium. Because if I happen to know what the amount of H3O plus is at equilibrium, I can just plug it in, like what we did for strong acids. And it was so easy with strong acids because HA is H. But these are not strong, these are weak, and HA does not equal H. But man, oh man, Ashevitz. Man, it would be really, really nice if we knew a way that using a Ka statement to find this value in a Ka statement. It would be really, really nice. Oh, there's a typo here. There should be a negative F. It would be really, really nice if we can use some algebra to find this value. Well, wait a minute. They give us the concentration of the acid. They give us the concentration of the Ka. And so if I just had a skill, ice tables, too cold. That's right. They're back. Here come those ice tables, baby. Too cold to the rescue. So whether you could appreciate this or not, back in the day, anytime we deal with an ice table, we are trying to find amounts at equilibrium. And we're trying to find these amounts at equilibrium. The reason we're trying to find these amounts at equilibrium now is because if I can find what the H3O plus is, if I'm prim and proper, or the simplified version where I just take water out because water is a liquid, if I can find either of these two values, I can just plug it in to that the pH is the negative log of H. The whole freaking problem is, what is H? Well, just like what we did last unit, if we use an ice table, too cold. And if I know initially, as per this question, I have an initial amount of acid with no other common ion in the solution. I know that I'm dealing with one molar for the HA. In this case, HA is HF. I know that I have zero hydronium to begin with. I have zero conjugate base, aka fluoride, to begin with. And because it is a balanced 1:1:1 chemical ratio, same thing if the water is involved, because it's a 1:1:1, just like what we did last unit, it's minus X plus X plus X. And just like what we did towards the end of last unit, even though technically I lose a little bit of the HF, that minus X, that X is so small, it's such a small amount that it's just going to be poo-poo Pikachu'd away. That X is going to be such a small amount that we're just going to ignore it. So the amount I have of acid at initial is the amount I have at equilibrium. However, that gain in X, because I had nothing to begin with, that gain in X for hydronium is a momentous amount, and that gain of X in F minus is a momentous amount, the conjugate base. So just like what we did last unit, we're gonna use, quote unquote, use that ice table to find what we have at equilibrium to plug it into your Ka statement first to find out what X is. Just like what we did last unit, X is the amount of H plus, X is the amount of conjugate base, A minus, and I have an amount of acid. So now that I have two out of the three terms in this algebraic equation, since H and F are the same, I really have X squared over one molar. I want to get X all alone. So I'm going to multiply the left side by one molar. Whatever I do to one side, I got to do to the other. So I end up with Ka times HA concentration, aka 7.2 times 10 to the negative 4 times 1.00 molar equals X squared. I want to get X all alone, so I take the square root. And if you plug it into your calculator correctly, 7.2 times 10 to the negative 4 times 1 is 7.2. Square root of 7. Or times 10 to the negative 4. Square root of 7.4 times 10 to the negative 4 is 0.27, or 2.7 times 10 to the negative 2 molar. Now this is what breaks my heart, because students get all the way to here. We remember to do all this for the week acid, and we go, whoa, let's go, I got the answer. No. What you got was X. And the reason why you got X is because this is what X is. X is X, duh, Mahan. But what X really is X is the amount of hydronium, and X is also the amount of conjugate base at equilibrium. So I did all of that work to find X. In last unit, unit 7, congratulations. You just found S. You found molar solubility. You just found the amount at equilibrium. Here, we're doing... All right, so we're going to do all that fun stuff just to find X, right? So the top three bullet points are just everything from the same, from the previous slide. So now that we did all that fun for X, again, the reason why we did that, ladies and gentlemen, was to find the concentration of H. Last unit, you would have just stopped right there, said this is the molar solubility, this is the S value, this is the X value, let's go. But we are doing that for a reason. We are finding X in this case to find the concentration of H plus, or properly H3O plus, at equilibrium. So now that we finally did all of that, we can finally plug in our value of H plus at equilibrium, which, as we found on the previous slide, X was 0.027 molar. So now I can plug that in and I find that this has a pH of 1.57. Fun, right? No, it's not fun at all, Mahan. Now, I hate teaching tricks, ladies and gentlemen. I hate this. However, I do have to be cognizant of the fact that this test is timed, and I want you to be able to kind of see some stuff here. Now, if you did enough of this practice, what you are going to find is that for every single weak acid solution, so long as it's only a weak acid, ladies and gentlemen, you're going to see later on in the unit, we're going to have buffers where we're going to have a weak acid and its conjugate in solution. We're going to have some weak acid and common ions, or not common common ions. We're going to titrate and all this fun stuff. If it's just a weak acid, you're going to have an ice table very similar to the one we just had on the previous slide. You're going to have some concentration of the acid to begin with no hydronium, no conjugate base. You're always going to lose a little bit of acid, and that loss is always going to be a minor, teeny tiny little bit amount. But that little bit that you've lost is everything to the hydronium and the conjugate base. So you're always going to end up with this, guys. Always. You're always going to end up, if it's just a weak acid, you're always going to end up with that the concentration of the acid that it began with is the concentration of the acid, quote unquote, at equilibrium. And you're always going to end up with your concentration of H plus being X and your concentration of A minus being X. And again, the Ka statement, if it's a weak acid, is always going to be hydronium times conjugate base over concentration of acid. And so what's always going to end up happening is we're always going to sub in X for both the H plus and the A minus, and the concentration of the acid never changes. So you're always going to end up with X squared over whatever the concentration of the acid was to begin with is your Ka, just like what we ended up with on the last slide. And you're always going to find X, going to multiply by HA, and whatever you do to one side, you do to the other. And so you're always going to end up with X squared equals Ka times the concentration of the acid to begin with. To get rid of that square, we got to take the square root. And so you're always, quote unquote, always going to end up with, for a weak acid, if it's just a weak acid all alone, not being titrated, not buffer, you always end up with X equals square root of Ka times HA. And we're always doing that because pH is the negative log of H. But for a weak acid, it's even better. pH just equals the negative log of X. Woo! Just a little bit different than strong acids, right? Now, One of the other reasons why you're going to have to use that exact same ice table and do that exact same slash sarcasm fun is because they might also ask you this question. What is the percent dissociation? What is the percent ionization of an acid? And if you can appreciate what they're asking you and what you're doing, anytime you find any percents ever, and guys, this is not on the reference sheet, not on the reference sheet. Anytime you find a percent of anything, it's always part over whole. So if they're asking you what's the percent dissociation, if it's a strong acid, it's 100%. I had 16 moles that went in, 16 moles came out, 16 divided by 16 is 1, 1 times 100 is 100. But for a weak acid, it's how much H did you get, how much H did you get, versus how much acid did you start with. That'll tell you the percent of it that dissociated, the percent of it that dissolved and became H+. Wait a minute, what is H+ again at equilibrium? That's right, H+ is X. So you might have to do all of that work I just showed you. X equals the square root of Ka times Ha. You might use all that same work, but instead of using it to find the negative log of X to find pH, we might do all of that same work to actually find the percent dissociation instead of pH. You're finding what X is at equilibrium, which is what H is at equilibrium. So we can do two things with that. We can find pH by taking the negative log of it, or we could find the percent dissociation by dividing it by the acid concentration times 100%. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this is also another way to find your H plus at equilibrium. Because if they give you percent ionization and original concentration, it's algebra, then you could find X that way. As a fun fact, usually as the more and more you dissolve, the more and more you dilute it, you're actually decreasing your denominator while not really changing X. X is X, it's gonna dissociate to a minor degree anyway. So you actually are increasing the percent dissociation because you're making the acid itself weaker while keeping the same amount of H. All right, so what if they give us a weak base at equilibrium? Well, guess what? Again, this is why this unit becomes really, really fun. If they give you a weak base, the only weak base that you should be very, very comfortable with and see and know, the only weak base that you have to have memorized is ammonia, nitrogen trihydride, Bronsted-Lowry's base. Well, guess what? if it's not ammonia and it doesn't have a hydroxide, an OH in it, they're either gonna give you double arrows or they're gonna give you a KB now, KB for base. So same idea here, we're gonna do almost the exact same thing we did for the weak base, but now we just have to appreciate that we're dealing with a weak base, not a weak acid. Still, it's gonna be products over reactants, which in this case we call the conjugate acid of the base. We call it BH plus because it's whatever the base is and it's accepted in H plus. And what it does is it takes that H off of water or whatever else, and it leaves behind hydroxide. So now instead of having H plus hydronium and conjugate base and A minus, I now have hydroxide, OH minus, and conjugate acid. This too, ladies and gentlemen, is provided on your reference sheet. So we're going to do everything we just did, but with, again, that extra little coat of paint, that understanding that we're actually solving for bases first, and then we've got to subtract that out from 14 if we're at 25 degrees Celsius. So what would this look like, ladies and gentlemen? Well, the exact same thing, but opposite. Weak bases, again, are gonna have these small KB values. That means they don't really dissociate. It means that they want to stay together as a base. It does not want to accept that H+. So a weak base, just like a weak acid gives us a very strong conjugate base, a weak base actually gives us a very strong conjugate acid because in reality, equilibrium lives far to the left. If they gave us a question where we were going to calculate the pH of a weak base, we're going to do everything. We're going to use that ice table again to find out how much hydroxide is there at equilibrium. We're going to find X, But this time we are finding hydroxides because we are dealing with bases, not acids. We're going to find that pOH first because I'm dealing with bases, and I'm going to subtract that from 14 if we're at 25 degrees Celsius, which, as much as AP Chem sucks, usually we're dealing with all these at 25 degrees Celsius. Now, if it's not at 25 degrees Celsius, or if you don't like dealing with pOH and then subtracting it from 14, just like to close out the last vodcast, we can use equilibrium values and we can use additional information to help us. So if you'd rather deal with the ice table from pH perspective in the H's, even though it's a base, you can also use this magical equation that we have not discussed before. And so just like 14 equals pH plus pOH, there's another relationship when we deal with weaks. There's a relationship when we deal with K values. And that's that the KW of water is always going to equal the Ka times the KB of water. So again, at 25 degrees Celsius, that value is 1 times 10 to the negative 14. So what I actually could do is I could actually take the KB value that they provided for me, divide it, and I could then find the Ka. Because Ka equals KW divided by KB, I can find Ka, and then I'm off and running with the fact that X equals the square root of Ka times HA. And we can rock and roll. So we're going to practice this pH of the weak base a little bit more in class. But again, it's just the same thing we did two slides ago, but find the pOH first and subtract it from 14. All right. So hopefully this podcast helped you appreciate why weak acids are different than strong acids. And guys, this is going to be the thing that we're going to be driving home. Whoo! So the cows come home. Have a great day.